to the setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me.
Oh, wouldn't deny you if you ask me. I'd rather die than to blaspheme. But if I need a ride in your backseat, will you be there for me? See me on the path on your way home. Might need a mattress to sleep on. But if I'm gonna dawn, would it be wrong? Will you be there for me?
Will you walk with me down on the street? Talk to me, tell me what you see. Stand by me so the world will see you and me in unity. Hey, 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 you and me in unity. Hey, 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 you and me in unity.
I will be the heart and the beat.
Good morning, Oasis. Good morning, good morning. Please stand and join us while we worship.
Come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms.
He has open arms.
For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. His one and only Son to save us. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
Buried beneath my rebellion, lost without hope of redemption, blind of my need for a savior. Oh, but God,
crushed by the weight of my failure, living the lie I created, digging my grave without knowing. Oh, but God, oh, but God, rich in mercy, how you love me too much to let me stay lost. My salvation sent from heaven, nailing my sin to a cross. Oh, but God, you gave me a truth worth believing, and I traded my chains for your freedom. Oh, you were the one that I needed. Oh, but God, resurrected my heart from the ruins, and my rescue came through like the morning. And now this is my sure testimony. Oh, but God, oh, but God, rich in mercy, how you love me too much to let me stay lost. My salvation sent from heaven, nailing my sin to a cross. Oh, but
Supper. So those of you watching online, those of you in the house, it's appropriate for you at home to get some juice and some bread or a cracker. And those of you in the house, we have stations in the front and the back. And I'd like to participate together today, to be able to take the emblems together. So you got a little bit of time before we're going to do that together. So I want you to think about, you know, I get asked, why do we do this every week here at church? Well, it's very, very, very significant. I mean, one of the reasons, of course, is Jesus said, do this as often you meet. Do this in remembrance of me. So one of the things I enjoy doing each year is reading through the Bible. I use a Bible app to do that. And when you're reading through the Old Testament, you get this image so clearly. And I would encourage you to read through the Bible in a year. It only takes about 15 minutes a day in order to do that. But when you learn about the Old Testament versus the New Testament, you realize that Israel was under the Old Testament, the law, and what they did to roll back sin was they sacrificed animals. I mean, everything from pigeons to bulls. And the high priest would take that blood and they would do very specific things with the blood of the sacrifice. Sometimes they'd put it on an earlobe, a thumb, or a big toe. Sometimes they would sprinkle it over the altar. Very, very specific. And the reason why was God wanted them to realize only He could take away sin. And it required sacrifice. So that's under the law. We're under the grace now of God, and we can be so thankful for that. And the Bible tells us this about Jesus. This is why we don't sacrifice animals anymore in the temple or in the tabernacle prior to that. It's because the Bible says in the book of Hebrews that Jesus was sacrificed for sin once and for all. Once and for all. So when we read the Old Testament, we get that impression of what sin's all about, that they were pushing back sin by doing the sacrifice, but now we're under grace, and once and for all, we have our sins forgiven when we follow Jesus Christ and receive Him as Lord and Savior. So when we do this weekly, He says, do this in remembrance of Me. It's literally represents the blood and the body of Jesus. Now, we're not sprinkling His blood or the juice over any altar, but we're taking it in and we're remembering the sacrifice weekly that was paid for our sin. We'll never realize our need for a Savior if first we don't realize that we're sinners. So we get these emblems, and right now we thank the Lord for what He's doing. In fact, let's just say that right now. You can close your eyes if you want to and just say, thank You, God. You love me so to send Your one and only Son. Amen. Once and for all. So Jesus, at the Lord's Supper, said, do this in remembrance of Me, and we remember His sacrifice, and we take in this bread. He took the cup and said, this is the cup of the new covenant in My blood. Remember My sacrifice. Remember Your sin. Remember what I did for you. And we do this in remembrance of Him. And we celebrate the Lord's death, burial, and resurrection until He comes. It's so exciting.
Please stand and join us whenever you're ready.
Come out of sadness from wherever You've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find Your mercy, O sinner, come near. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down Your burdens, lay down Your shame. All who are broken, lift up Your face. Oh, wanderer, come home, You're not too far. Lay down Your hurt, lay down Your heart, come as You are. There's hope for the hopeless and all those who strayed. Come sit at the table, come come taste the grace, His rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart. Come as you are. Oh, sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart. Come as you are.
Thank you. Please may be seated. In the church, and I have always believed, and just through my life, just never really committed. And I think about it all the time, and I've been praying about it, and I've been seeing signs. Because I want to commit to God.
Well, I found out pretty recently, a couple days ago, that I couldn't feel God anymore, and I decided that it was so urgent that I needed to get it done.
The time was right. Like, it came to me. I spoke to a few of my, you know, mentors with everything. And they said, just, they heard the change, and I'm ready to lead my family into Christ. Like, I'm to be that leader and be the step to bring fire. Yes, absolutely.
But there's been some things that have happened in life that I haven't forgiven myself for. I just feel more and more like I'm in need of His help. And I keep getting called just to talk to Him and pray and try and figure it out. And I'm like, you know, the fact that I feel like I need to do this tells me that it's time for me to forget myself and start.
Say, I believe.
I believe.
I believe.
I believe.
Jesus is the Christ.
Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of God.
The Son of God.
The Son of God.
The Son of God.
And I receive Him.
And I receive Him.
And I receive Him.
As my Lord and Savior.
Lord and Savior.
As my Lord and Savior.
As my Lord and Savior.
Church. Oh, welcome to all of you in the house, all of you watching online. It's great to be able to worship the Lord in His house, we call it. If you're brand new with us, I encourage you to download our church app so you know what's going on. If you want to know a lot more that's going on, subscribe to our weekly email and receive that. And you can read through what's happening, even community events. But let's highlight what's going on today. Right now, after the service, what we're going to do is we're going to pack some backpacks of love, where we partner with one of the local schools and get some kids some food that they can have during break. So we're going to be doing that right after service today. The luncheon, ladies, if you want to go to the luncheon, I think they're going to your favorite spot this time. Where? The Pizza Ranch. Yeah, you guys know how to party there. So if you're like brand new and like, hey, I'd love to go check out that lunch, well, go by Connecting Point and find out all the details for that. Easter services coming up. You believe that? Just a little bit now, a couple of Sundays. And what I'd encourage you to do, if you can, either go to the later or the earlier service and leave that middle one. It's typically the one that fills up for the guests that'll be coming. And so if you can do that, encourage you to do that at those times. The Colorado Life Initiative, we have a signature board, a petition that you can sign to get life onto the ballot this fall. So if you've not filled that out, or you don't know what I'm talking about, ask about that following the service. The burritos, they're going to be sold next week for the youth fundraiser. And I think we might have our camp help designated by now. I'm not sure. We had some interested people earlier. So a camp leader, we were looking for a male to do that during that time. Child dedication, if you'd love to dedicate your child. It's like, you know, I got my baby. I know I need my church family to help raise the pray for me and my family. We're going to do that on April the 7th. We'll get you up here, take pictures, and pray over your family. Also, Baptism Sunday, as you saw. And let me just say something about that. We baptized, like the people that you just saw in that clip there, those were people who have been baptized since our last Baptism Sunday in December. And we baptize at any time. When you understand the urgency of baptism, they did it like right now. And so if you've never taken that step, we can do that immediately. We can do that. We do the Baptism Sundays because we have a portable. We don't have a big baptistry that we maintain week to week. So that's one of the explanations why we do a Baptism Sunday. to make sure that's available to all. But we do that at any time. So if that's you, let us know. As we think about now worshiping through giving, Philippians 4, we'll put that up on the screen in verse 11. The Bible says this, I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. I mean, if you've ever experienced contentment, well, largely that has to do with a lot of things, but here I'm applying it to financials. And when you are a content person financially, well, you're likely not to be in very much debt, if any. You're likely to be very, very generous. You're likely not to be a spendthrift and spend more than you make. When you're content, it brings perspective. So as we think about giving and preparing our hearts to give today, I want you to think about how contentment is one of the keys to freely give to God. So if you give regularly, we thank God for that. If you give sporadically, well, I would challenge you to think about giving regularly. If you don't give, I would challenge you to read what God says about giving as he brings contentment into your life when you give. So let me word a prayer for our offerings today. Father, we thank you for Jesus and you giving us Jesus, your one and only Son, a sacrifice for sin that we might know that we are forgiven and live in that, to live in that contentment, to know that we're free of shame, free of guilt, free of what sin brings into people's lives. And I thank you for that. I pray that through our offerings, we would be able to help grow your kingdom. Lord, you've got a plan, and that involves contentment. It involves a learning curve, and I pray that we would go after the things that you would have us to go after. Thank you for that. Thank you for a generous church, one that gives. And we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Stand up and introduce yourself to somebody and say, I am grateful. I am grateful for this church. I am grateful for the pastor. No, stand up and say, I'm grateful to somebody. Hey, if you're joining us for the very first time, we're in the near the end of this series, and week number 4, in fact, we have one more in this series called Character Calibration, and I can't say enough that I don't know if I've ever been burdened, spiritually burdened, to share a message series with you because of what I see going on in our society today. I mean, the culture has become secular. The culture has become anti-Christian. And so I think we live in a world today where godly character has just been left behind by society at large. And I believe that the church, every Christ follower should seek out the positive character traits that we read about in Scripture and calibrate our lives accordingly and lead the way with godly character. Proverbs 11 and verse 6 reads, the righteousness of the upright delivers them, but the unfaithful are trapped by evil desires. So we led off this series talking about calibrating honor. We talked about loyalty. We talked about integrity last week. Today, though, I want to talk to you about a virtue that's almost totally forgotten in our culture today. And I'll give you an example of this to lead into the message. There was a professor, a Boston consultant. He worked with college graduates. And he said, talking to a bunch of college graduates, he said, you know, you guys are up and coming. You're getting ready to enter the workforce. He said, you guys have been actually described by a word that begins with the letter E. Do you know what that might be? And they said, energetic, enthusiastic, or excellent, exceptional. And he went through the list of all these E's. He said, no, really, your generation that's getting ready to go into the workforce, you have been described with this mindset of entitlement. Entitlement. Somebody say entitlement.
Entitlement.
Yes, and it's not just the younger generation, those going into the workforce. I mean, this entitlement mindset really is everywhere today, I think. How have we raised up a society that's developed such a sense of entitlement? I think I can point to a few things. He's preaching right up front here. But one of the things is, those of you who are my age and older, well, you know, a lot of you work too much. Maybe you neglected your family. Maybe you ended up in divorce, but you kind of countered that because you didn't give the time that you needed to your kids. But what else, what did you give them instead? Anything. Like, here you go, what do you need? And they developed this mindset, I can get anything I want whenever I want it. And also, I think part of that, it's contributed to this entitlement mindset, is that we've overly protected the younger generation. I don't know about you, but when I grew up and I was a kid, I rode in the back bed of a truck with a dozen of my buddies. Anybody do that? Anybody remember that? I know. It's like now, it's like we're buckled in and we're riding the Indianapolis 500, you know? And you can't even ride a bicycle without a helmet. I kid you not, I saw this last Sunday after church. I looked out my window and saw a parent on a bicycle, and a little bitty tot, he's riding a little bicycle. He had a full face motorcycle helmet. He could barely hold the thing up. And it's because the parents going, nobody getting hurt on my watch, you know. And we protected the kids. And it doesn't stop there. When I was a kid, you actually had to win something to get a trophy. Now what do you do? I know, let's say amen. All you have to do now is show up. Oh, Johnny, I'm so glad you came in last place. Here's a trophy. Oh, you deserve that, son. You know, what happened? We've created, and the younger generations that come after us, the people who feel entitled. And it's not just them. It's me. I was thinking about this last week. My phone, anybody get notifications on your phone? Well, turn them off right now. You're in church. But my phone started blowing up last week. And I started thinking about the phone in my hand. I'm like, isn't it amazing? A smartphone. All the things that you can do with a phone. I mean, I can order a pizza and have it meet me at my house when I get there. I can order a car and have the car delivered to my house. If I had a smartphone, which I don't, I have a below average intellect home. I have a dumb home. But anywhere in the world, if I had a smart home, I can touch buttons on my phone and change the temperature and turn off and on the lights just with a smartphone. And I was thinking about this last week. Last week I was at the gym, and I'm trying to download a podcast, or just to sign on to the podcast, and it's spinning and spinning. And after 3 seconds, I'm so frustrated. And then it kept kicking me off the internet because I tried to sign on to the internet, and then I had to, like, delete out of it and re-sign in 3 different times before I could get that to download. And I was furious because why? I'm entitled and I want it now. So what I want to do today, I want to talk about the opposite of entitlement. And I want to look at this godly character trait of gratitude. Somebody say gratitude. Gratitude. Amen. So I want to look at what the Bible has to say about it. There's an interesting story about these guys who were blessed, but they really didn't all seemingly have a grateful heart. So let's look at this passage of Scripture in Luke chapter 17. And the Bible says this, beginning with verse 11. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, how many men? 10 men. Who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. So let me pause and just fill in a little bit of the context here. Leprosy. If you had leprosy, it was one of the most painful and shameful diseases that you could have at the time. Literally, your body is like rotting, the flesh is. And it affected the nerve ending so much so as if like a leper who's outcast or lying in an alley sleeping, they could have like a toe gnawed off and not even realize it because they didn't feel any pain in their extremities. So this social difficulty existed, but the Old Testament tells us that if you were a leper, you had to rip your clothing to signify, I have leprosy. And if somebody walked too close to a leper, they would have to yell, unclean, unclean, and just so they could have it. Can you imagine having that social distancing, if you will? And can you imagine not hugging somebody or shaking somebody's hand because you have this dreaded disease? So you look at this, and there's this group of 10 men. They're looking across the street at this Jesus who maybe they've even seen done some miracles. And they cried out to him, and because their lives could be changed in an instant. And we read this. It says, when Jesus saw them, they cried out. He said, go and show yourselves to the priest. Now, whenever you would show yourself to a priest, if you were a leper, it was because you were clean at that moment. So I'm filling in the gap there. Go show yourself to the priest. They walked in faith to the priest. And as they were walking, as they went, they were cleansed. A miracle of God, instantaneous, just like that. Their greatest dream, their greatest prayer had come true in an instant. Then the verse that comes up next is very surprising. And it says this, one of them. How many of them out of the 10? One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. He thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. So to make his point even more poignant, Jesus said he was not even Jewish. He was a Samaritan. And Jesus asked, and you can sense his surprise, who he's teaching, were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except for this foreigner? And you can almost see the and hear the incredulous voice of Jesus. Where are the other 9? One guy came back and was thankful, was grateful. What were the other thinking? They had been crying out, begging to be healed, and they were, and only one comes back. Now, you got to think, were these guys really bad? Or maybe the 9, they were good-hearted, but they just wanted to get back to their families and say, I've been healed by Jesus? Or did they have this mindset of entitlement? Well, he healed everybody else. I just got what was coming to me. Only one stopped to thank God for his blessing. So my question to you, I'm going to put it up on the screen. Will you be the one? Will you be the one? Will you be the one? And listen, the odds are stacked against you, but will you be the one that daily pauses to give thanks to God, the one who's blessed you? Will you be the one to stop long enough in the busyness of this world to lift up praise to the creator and sustainer of this universe? Will you be the one to thank him for sending his son Jesus and doing something for you that you could not do on your own to forgive your sins? And it's not just with God. Think about it with other people who've impacted you. Will you be the one that stops long enough to write a thank you note to express your gratitude to somebody who's blessed your life? Will you, as you exit today, if you're a parent, thank the one who's taking care of your child, teaching your child about the Bible? Will you be the one to say, thank you for ministering to my family the way that you do? Will you be the one to stop and thank a coach or to thank a teacher or a mom or dad? Will you be the one to stop and show gratitude? Or will you say, like most people today, I had it coming to me, I deserved all of that? Will you be the one? So let's look at another story that Jesus taught in the New Testament. And it kind of shows, illustrates perfectly this ungrateful mindset. And it's a story of two brothers. And you may know this story as the prodigal son. But you can see the ungrateful attitude in the hearts of both the younger and the older brother. And the younger brother, if you're taking notes and you want to fill this in, he had the ungrateful mindset that says, I want it now. Somebody say, I want it now. I want it when? I want it now, right? We've been so conditioned. I want it now. And this is the attitude of this younger brother. We're going to read in Luke 15. There was a man who had how many sons? Two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate because I want it now. Now, typically, you would receive your inheritance when your parents died, but not this guy. He's like, Dad, I don't like your values. I don't like any of this. Give me my inheritance. I'm going to go live my own life because I know how to do it better. I want it now. And the father, fought, for whatever reason, gave his son the inheritance. And if you know the story, the Bible says he went out and squandered away his inheritance. He blew it all. He wasted it. He hired women. He lived wildly. And he threw keg parties. It's in the Bible. Well, I didn't really say that. But what it took the father perhaps years or decades to accumulate, this son, this ungrateful son, totally wasted his inheritance in a matter of weeks or just months. So what's interesting to me is there are so many people today that have this I want it now mindset. I want it now. And maybe it is with the younger generation. I know I've had people sit across from me who are younger who wanted what their parents had. I want to drive that car. I want that vacation. I want this kind of house. And they got in over their head, and they come because they're in a financial strain. And that's the attitude to get you. I want it now, and it'll get you in trouble. Now, it's been a long time ago since I was a little boy. But when I was a little boy, my grandparents had this philosophy. It was old. It was archaic. This philosophy they have, and it's hard to understand. It's hard for me to describe it, but I'll try to explain it. They believe that if you wanted something and you didn't have the money for it, you saved up your money before you bought it. And you're like, why didn't they just put down a credit card and do it, right? I know, that's what we're talking about. It's crazy, but if you wanted something, you just didn't buy it. And they would actually save up their money, and they would do something that's called wait. Can somebody say wait? They waited. How archaic is that? Because we've been conditioned and trained. Oh, if I want it, I want to get it now. I deserve it now. So if you're really in debt today, except for some tragedy in your life, it might be that you have a little bit of this entitlement mindset. So call it what it is, if that's you. Number two, the ungrateful mindset. This is of the older brother in Jesus' story. Is I deserve more. I deserve more. So if you know the story, the son, the younger one goes out and blows it all. And he comes to his senses, the Bible says. And he said, that was dumb. Even the servants at my dad's house are doing better off than I am. Maybe I'll go back and I'll beg my dad, can I just serve there and be one of your servants, a hired hand right now. So when he comes back to his father, and the father in the story represents our heavenly father, and you got to read into the story too that the father maybe went out every day, looked across the horizon, hoping to see his younger son to come back. One day he did, and the Bible says he just went out and rushed him and hugged him and embraced him and said, bring me the coat, bring me the ring, kill the fatted calf. We're having steak tonight, medium rare. And everybody said amen to that. And the big brother starts, what's he do? He starts whining and has a pity party. He said, I obeyed all the rules. I never got that. You never did that for me. I've never even broken a rule. I deserve more and more than what you've given me. And he complains. Look at what the Bible says in verse 29. Look, he said to his dad, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat, so I could celebrate with my friends. Yeah, that joke didn't really go over too good, but I deserve better. Have you ever felt like the older brother? Have you ever felt like that? Well, I deserve a better paying job. If I don't get one, I'm quitting. Oh, I deserve these benefits. Oh, I deserve this vacation. I mean, it's crazy today, 13-year-olds, it's like they feel like they're punished because they don't have a smartphone, you know, or they complain because they don't have the smartphone that they like. You know, it's crazy, this entitlement mindset. Where did they learn that? Point the fingers back to us. I deserve this kind of vacation. Oh, this is what I deserve, this kind of house. I'm worth it. The ungrateful mindset. one of the nine, but not the one. So what I want to do is I want us to examine our own hearts, you know, and for God to do a work on us. There are three areas, I believe, that I want to look at and ask God, is there any ungratefulness in one of these areas that I might have? And like you're going to have this openness with God right now. And I want to deal with this biblically. I want to deal with it maybe severely. And I want to talk about two phrases. But let's ask God to expose in just a minute. But I want to expose any material and financial ungratefulness in our life. So if you have your outline open, you'll see there's a blank there. And if this is you, you're going to check this line here. So you got to think, is there anything in my life where I have this ungrateful spirit? And you think about, you know, if I just had a smarter TV, I think I'd be happy. Yeah. Or in your house, you know, I don't know if we have all the space that we need. I mean, how can I raise godly kids if I had to put two in the same room? I don't know if it works like that. Or I don't like my car. I hear people saying this, you know. I don't like my car. It doesn't have heated seats. You know, I don't like my car. It's over 5 years old. Oh, it doesn't have Bluetooth. Oh, let me just get a brand new one so I can go in debt for 6 more years. Let me just keep that going. Somebody was telling me a while back how their kid got into an older truck and he sat in it and he said, oh, check this out. Look at this new technology. And the kid's cranking down the window. I know, and I get frustrated. Why? Because I have to actually hold my button until the window goes down all the way instead of just clicking it and let it go down automatically. I'm entitled. But if you're constantly thinking things like, oh, I wish I had more money. I wish I had a better job. I wish I had a better car. I wish I had a better house. Well, maybe you need to check this box and call it what it is. And because of your mindset, your ungrateful mindset, let God work on you with this. Maybe it could be relational ungratefulness. It could be that you're sick and tired of your parents meddling in your business. Or my parents don't do this or they don't do that. And you complain about that. Oh, well, you don't know my husband. I just wish he was a better spiritual leader. And, you know, I pray for him every day. Or I wish my wife, I wish she cooked more. I just wish she was more intimate or whatever that might be. I'm not happy because I don't have a girlfriend. I'm not happy because I don't have a boyfriend. My friends aren't this and they're not that or whatever. If you're relationally ungrateful, well, check that one and let God work on your heart with that. Thirdly, maybe yours is just circumstantial. Everything that you look at, you whine like the older brother. Well, I really don't like my job. I don't like where I live. I don't like my hair. I don't like my lack of hair. I don't get any of the breaks. Call it what it is and allow God to work on your attitude with this. So let's deal with it biblically and see how might we can transform an ungrateful heart to a grateful heart, how we can transform, how we can go from a sense of entitlement to a sense of gratitude, of being grateful. So how do we do it? Two phrases here. Decide before God, and you say this, every blessing, God, that you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And you make the decision. I'm going to count my blessings. And I'm going to thank God for the blessings. And that phrase came from a verse from a song. It says, every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. I would sing it to you, but you wouldn't praise God for that if I did. So this is why it's so important, because phrase number two, every blessing I don't return praise turns into pride. Every blessing that I don't count and thank God for turns into pride. I deserve this. I had this coming to me. I deserve more. I want it now. It's that sense of entitlement. I want it now. I deserve it. So what's the remedy? What's the remedy to make that move? Well, let's look at what the Bible says in Philippians chapter 4. We read part of it earlier. I have learned... So this is something that we learn. I have learned to be what? Content, whatever the circumstances. Whatever the circumstances. If I'm healthy or if I'm not. if I'm wealthy or if I'm not, if I don't like my job or if I like my job or don't like it, whichever, if I got a lot of hair or if I don't, whatever it is, I know what it is to be in need, Paul says, and I know what it is to have plenty. And then he says this, I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. It's something you learn. It's a mindset. It's something you train yourself by getting into the scriptures. It's something that you learn. And it says, and this is the secret. What's the secret? I can do, somebody help me, everything through him who gives me strength. It's learned. It's developed. It's internalized. By nature, most of us are not grateful. By nature, we're sinners. By nature, I'm not content. I've told people that, and they said, well, you're the pastor. Well, I'm a person, too. And I'm going to tell you this. By nature, I'm very, very dissatisfied. And by nature, I'm a complainer. But I'm learning. I'm learning. Ecclesiastes 6 says, better what the eye sees than the roving of the appetite. Better what God's put before you, the blessings that he's put before you that you recognize rather than roaming, looking for something more, longing that, oh, I wish I had this, I wish I had that. Better what the eye sees than the roving of the appetite. We've got to count our blessings. I'll tell you a story. It just kind of helps with this, I think. We were in Michigan just a few years ago and visiting my wife's family. And the brothers-in-law, sisters, cousins, niece, nephews, everybody. And we were at Lake Michigan. Anybody ever been to Lake Michigan? Well, even on a warm day, the water's cold. So we're there. We're on the beach, you know, good day. Cloudy, overcast, not the best. So us older folks, we didn't make our way into the water. But the kids did. You know, they went in. They got used to it. They're out playing. And I looked at one point and saw my two boys that are building a sandcastle, and Camden and Gage. And we were talking a little bit more, and it was one of those moments when I looked up and I saw only Camden was at the sandcastle, and I looked out and I saw the kids, our kids, the cousins and all, but I didn't see Gage. And it was in that moment, if you've ever experienced that, you know the fear that'll well up in you, that sense of anxiety, that sense of, well, what am I going to do now? And I'm looking. I actually stood up, and the panic began to overwhelm me because I'm a pessimist. I'm negative. You know, I'm having all that stuff coming up and thinking the thoughts that I did. And my world changed in that moment when I was looking for Gage. It's like, did he go all the way up to the restroom area on his own? Did somebody? And Denise, my wife, said, what's wrong? And I said, Gage, I can't find Gage, and, you know, in that near panic. And she said, he's out in the water with the cousins. And I'm like, no, he's not. And she could see from her vantage point, and she waved, and then I saw Gage wave. He'd been behind his taller relatives. In that moment, like in an instant, I went from panic being the most grateful person on the planet. My circumstances hadn't changed, but it was my perspective that changed. I mean, here I am. It's a cloudy day still, but I got my family, my kids, even my in-laws. But my heart just opened with gratitude. Still a cloudy day, but in my heart there was happiness. What changed it all? Perspective. It's just about perspective. Proverbs 15 says, the cheerful heart has a what? Continual feast. Better a little with the fear of the Lord than great wealth with what? Turmoil. Better what the eye sees than a roving of the appetite. So the next time you see, oh, I'm sick of my car, say, God, I am thankful for the car that you've given me. I'm like in the top 5% in the world. I have a car. I might have a car and a truck too. Oh, my house is too small. What a mess. Oh, God, I'm thankful that you've blessed me with a family and in-laws that come over and mess it all up. Oh, my house is too small. Oh, God, I'm thankful I have a toilet. I have a furnace. I have running water. It might be a little small, but God, I thank you for that. Well, I really don't like my job and the people I work with. But God, I'm thankful I got a job and I can pay the bills. Thank you that I have work. Well, I don't like this about my body. Well, God, thank you that I have today. I thank you that I'm healthy. I thank you for my friends. And maybe more than all these material blessings that you've given to me, I thank you for your son Jesus and what you gave to me that I can't do on my own, that you sacrificed your son so I could be forgiven of my sins. Thank you, God, daily, that I can have life and have it to the full and have the hope of eternal life. God, I thank you. I thank you. And we calibrate gratitude. And we cultivate the attitude of gratitude. It's learned. It's something we can only develop. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. So will you be the one? Will you be the one? Will you be the one with gratefulness in your heart? Would you pray with me? Oh God, forgive us for having an ungrateful heart, and have mercy on us for our spirit of entitlement. Change us that we would never complain when you've blessed us beyond measure here in America especially. Oh God, with your help, let us turn every blessing that you pour out into praise. And Lord, help us to be the one. Help us to be the one. Oh, help us to be the one. Thank you for the blessing of knowing Jesus. And I know there might be one here today who doesn't. Somebody might be listening online right now, and they've never taken that step of faith to say, Jesus Christ, I want you to be my Lord and Savior. But today they're going to say, I'm going to do that. And they're going to step over that line. And you tell us very clearly in your word that whoever believes and is baptized, calling on the name of Jesus, that you'll forgive their sins as far as the east is to the west, and give us the hope of eternal life. Lord, thank you for that. Thank you for the significance of Scripture and teaching that. And maybe today we've been living a complaining life. Lord, let us learn from you the secret of being content in any and every situation. Oh, Lord, thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. If you decided to make Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, we'd love to know about that and walk with you through that. If you'd come forward to our prayer tables after we sing this song, if you have a prayer that you'd like somebody to pray with you for and with, we invite you to the prayer tables following this song.
Please stand and join us while we do.
Heart that is broken.
Remember, there are prayer tables on each end, and have a great Sunday.
We'll be right back. Jesus, friend of sinners, we have strayed so far away. We cut down people in your name, but the sword was never ours to swing. Jesus, friend of sinners, the truth's become so hard to see. The world is on their way to you, but they're tripping over me. Always looking around but never looking up, I'm so double-minded. A plank-eyed saint with dirty hands and a heart divided. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners,